Warning, the following podcast contains adult language and childish comedy. Listener discretion is advised. And now, please adjust your headphone volume to an unreasonable level and enjoy the most dynamic and electrifyingly entertaining podcast ever to conquer cyberspace. This is Amish Baby Machine.
Hello, friends, and welcome to the most powerful podcast ever created, the Amish Baby Machine Pop Culture Podcast. We have a powerful show today. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for listening. Thanks for downloading. I'm your beautiful host, Dags, and I'm going to throw it over to the powerful stereo tone, Mike Rez.
Hey, Dags. I think I got a little situation over here. I'm not quite sure. I think it's a water monitor on the loose here in the Twin Cities. I don't know if I see them out there or not, but I'm concerned because we have a lot of rabbits in our backyard, and I hear that water monitors pretty much eat anything that moves. I'm a little scared. So if I have to throw the mic down in the middle of the recording, it's because I have to wrestle a water monitor.
Now, what's going on? What's a water monitor?
It's a giant lizard from Asia. I mean, that like 2020 could be even more fucked up, but I guess water monitors are now the new thing here in our part of the country. So somebody's water monitor was let loose or got loose or something. I don't know. So we're on water monitor lookout in the Twin Cities of Minnesota. It's actually quite scary. I don't know what we're going to do.
Powerful. Powerful. Yeah. Be on the lookout for a 3 foot long monitor lizard. Powerful. Now, friends, we got a powerful show today. We got a powerful beer review. We checked out some powerful Netflix movies. We got new music I'm going to play. We got shout outs. It's going to be a great show.
Wait, you're going to play music?
Yes, sweet. We have powerful new music.
Nice.
It's going to be by Tangerine Beams. Stick around. That powerful music will play us out, as they say in the business. Now, Mike Rez, tell us what powerful shows on Netflix did we enjoy?
Oh, we watched a movie called The Core, which was made in 2003. And then we also watched it's actually a television show. It started off as a television show, and then Netflix picked it up, called Longmire, which is like a modern day CSI Wyoming, basically. So we're going to talk about that. It's quite interesting. Both of those forms of entertainment, the TV show and the movie. And I'm actually pretty excited to hear what your thoughts are on both of those.
Now, Mike Rez, last week we talked about, we had a powerful flyover.
Yes.
Powerful jets supporting the healthcare workers of Minnesota. Did you get a chance to hear, feel, or see the flyovers?
No, I did not. Unfortunately, I was too far north of where they were flying. So I didn't hear them. All I saw was the videos on social media accounts across the globe. So I'm hoping people got to see them, and hopefully members of the flock got to see them. They're happening all over the country.
I'm getting bored with flyovers, so I think we're going to need to step it up.
What are you thinking?
Well, I mean, like maybe an actual strafing run. I mean, I don't want anyone to get hurt, but maybe like fuck up some shit in the Walmart parking lot. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's kind of like,
I'm with you.
Yeah, you know, they do the flyover. It's kind of like fireworks. What do you think of fireworks? Are fireworks played out? Can we make those any more cooler?
I don't know if we can. I think we've pretty much hit the ceiling on what we can do with fireworks. I don't know if, like, you can. It was cool when they came out with the ones that could do the shapes. So you had like the smiley faces and the stars and the hearts. But I don't know how else you could make them cool other than just bigger and louder.
Yeah, they're going to have to incorporate like lasers, fireworks, small tactical nukes, something.
like a small half-ton or half-megaton blast coming out of one of those things.
Yeah, I mean, if it's far enough away, you're just going to see the flash. You know, it might, you might get a little temporary blindness. Big deal.
Everybody has to wear welding goggles just to go see the fireworks. Powerful. That would be awesome. Yeah.
Powerful steampunk goggles.
Yes.
I'm not a beer drinker, but for the fans, I had to do it. I went out and bought some powerful sours. Now, the sours you were talking about those last week, was that, or right, was that the week before?
I know we brought them up. We talked about them. And actually, sours have become quite the topic of conversation on social media for me since we started these beer reviews. So
what do you know about the sours? Tell the fans of Flock of Amish about sours.
Sours are exactly how they sound. They use tart fruit to give you the flavor and the taste in the beer. Usually the bitterness is not as high. Now you can get some where the IBUs are a little higher. The particular one that we will be talking about here in just a second is pretty low. Sours are kind of like the end thing. So IPAs were big for a while, and they still are around, and people enjoy them. But I think the sours are the new in thing to drink. So, and you found three of them, if I'm not mistaken, but we're only going to talk about one today, and then we'll save the other two for subsequent episodes.
Yeah, the one I enjoyed was Pryes Brewing. It's out of the great state of Minnesota. It is the Royal Raspberry Sour Ale. Now, I'm looking at the can right now, because we do enjoy the artwork on the cans. And I don't know, is it because of the sours, but it's not a very exciting can. It's almost got like a weird, I don't know, 1800s vibe or something.
Sure, I could see that. It's fancy. It looks like lace.
Yeah, it doesn't have a whimsical name either. Is that something different about the sours, or is that something they're changing, or do we know?
I think it could just be brewery choice.
Yes. Yep. So I'm looking on the back here, and they say it's a tart American fruited Berliner style Weiss that combines raspberry with hints of passion fruit, creating a crisp and approachable kettle sour.
When you hear the word Weiss or Weiss, that's a white beer automatically. So it's going to be made with a lot of wheat. And was it cloudy?
It was a little overcast. I think they were predicting rain. You know, I don't know enough about beer to tell you if it was cloudy or not. I did take powerful pics. Make sure you check them out on Twitter at Amish Bee Machine. Or also follow our Instagram, Amish Baby Machine. I took powerful pics of it.
Nice. I'm looking at some pictures online now. It looks like to be a little cloudy. Which is good, because you want your Weiss to be a little cloudy. That means that the wheat content is up there, which is what a good Weiss should be. Now, it's not a wit beer, which is German for white beer, so it's not going to be as cloudy as that. But it looks like, actually looks pretty good in these pictures and the pictures I saw that you posted.
So on the IBUs, they say it's a 5, so that's very low, right?
Very low, yeah. So it's going to be more sour than bitter.
Alcohol 4.8%, so that's very low too, right, for craft beer?
Yeah, for craft beer, that's right around your Coors Light, Miller Light area, so you're not going to get wasted off of like one of them, like that Golden Monkey.
Yeah, and they're saying flavor profile is tart and sweet, and they got this powerful little graph on the back. It's showing pointing towards raspberry. It's dry, citrus, and passion fruit.
Yeah, I'm looking at that right now, actually.
You know, I know nothing about beers, but this was very good.
Good.
In fact, it doesn't even taste like beer, and that's probably because there's no hops taste to it.
Right. That would be the why the bitterness units are so low.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of hops. I tried the IPAs. I'll keep trying them, but this one was very good. If anything, I wanted it to be more sour.
Really?
Yes.
Wow. So you're more of the sweet and sour taste in your beverages.
Yeah, I think this is probably the first one I've ever had two sours. Once again, I know nothing about beer, but I do know about energy drink.
So how would you compare it against an energy drink?
Well, it's funny you said that, because I just enjoyed right now. I enjoy Juice Monster. Nice. Powerful mango flavored.
Mm-hmm.
So this Royal Raspberry Sour Ale to me just tastes like an energy drink. You know,
an energy drink that'll get you wasted.
Yeah.
If you have enough of them.
It was good.
Good.
If anything, it needed to be more sour.
Really? Wow. I think you're, I think you need to start cutting back on the energy drinks.
Is yes. Really powerful.
So the sours are something I don't normally go to, but I will try them. So maybe I'll try this one.
Yes.
Since your review has been so glowing. Now, if the flock is familiar with the website Untappd, which is a website where people go and rate and tell people where you get, you know, what craft beers you've had, and then you get badges and whatnot. But it's getting a 3.92 out of 5. So people are enjoying this. I think we have a member of the flock, Sergeant Ed out of Maryland. He sent me a sour that he liked. And so I think he might be into this Royal Raspberry Sour if he can find it out in Maryland.
So he just got his shout out early because I had him on the shout out list.
Oh, did you? Nice. What's up, Sarge? So he's way into music too. So I've enjoyed going back and forth with him with the music as well. So, but when you pick these sours, he's actually the first person I thought about. I was like, well, maybe he'll enjoy your reviews of these sours. So it's Pryes Brewing out of Minneapolis, P-R-Y-E-S.
Yes, Pryes Brewing.
The flock wants to check it out. Pryes. We never really did figure out how to pronounce that, did we?
Called him up.
Oh, you did?
Yes.
Were you like,
powerful research.
Amish baby machine is here, and they're like, sweet.
Yeah, I said, hey, I'm going to need to fucking pronounce your joint over there.
Nice. So yeah. How many pint glasses out of 5 would you give it?
You know, because I don't drink beer, powerful references, I'm going 4 out of 5. I got to come up with something different. You have the pints. I'm going to go, I don't know. I got to come up with something cool yet. I haven't figured that out.
All right.
We'll do 4 out of 5 pints.
All right. So for this week, you'll do pint glasses. Next week, you'll have something.
Yes.
Some other ratings.
No, I liked it because a couple different things. I don't like alcohol taste, and I don't like that hoppy taste.
Yep.
And whatever you fucking beer nerds say, whatever. Not a fan of the hop taste. Some shouldn't taste piney and citrusy and floral. Should just be fucking good.
You like a raspberry sour.
And this was good. This is powerful. I enjoyed it. 4 out of 5 pints.
You know, it's funny you mentioned piney. There is a brewery in Oregon, I believe it's Astoria, Oregon, called St. George. And when we were there a few years ago, they had a beer. And it started off with, because it's Oregon and there's nothing but pine trees up there, it started off with 100 pounds of pine needles in the barrel. And I decided to try it, and it tastes like I was drinking a Christmas tree, but it was really good. You might want to back off on your dismissal of piney tasting beers.
I'll try your shitty beer. Is it still out?
I would have to find it. I don't know if we can get it in the cities, but definitely it was something you could get in Oregon 3 years ago.
Speaking of beers, let's do a quick cheers here. Flock of Amish, hold up your drink, hold up your beverage. Mike Rez, hold up your drink of choice.
Always.
Cheers, my friends. Thanks for listening to the most powerful podcast ever created, the Amish Baby Machine Pop Culture Podcast. We love everyone that listens. Please follow us on social media, Twitter at Amish Bee Machine. Instagram, Amish Baby Machine. We're everywhere, like our Facebook page. If you want to help support the show, please check out our merch. Convenient links on AmishBabyMachine.com. Also, we do have a Patreon page. That's a great way to help support this powerful podcast. Wherever you listen to podcasts, please leave a review. Please write something. 5-star review is the highest review. If you write that, it will unlock secrets to the universe. Now, Mike Rez, let's get into your song of the day. I had you pick a powerful song. Tell the fans of Flock of Amish what song you picked for a song of the day.
We have Sister Christian by the American hard rock band Night Ranger. This was a song that popped into my head as my daughter and I were driving in the car, and Sister Christian came on, and we were both singing it. Now, my daughter is 18, which puts her in the, you know, the early 2000s being born, but she knows the words to Sister Christian because as our kids have grown up, we have forced them to listen to old 80s rock and music in general, and the 90s and 70s and 60s as well. But it's always kind of funny to me to know what words to what songs my kids know, especially ones that were made when I was listening as a kid. But Sister Christian, I looked up some of the
motoring.
Heck yeah. The song was written by the drummer Kelly, I think it's Keggy or Keegi. I don't know how to pronounce that. There's
one of the powerful bands where the drummer is featured.
Right, like, Jay, like
Phil Collins, yeah.
Phil Collins, yeah. So he wrote and sang this song. And this was actually a song he wrote about his sister Christy. Now, how they got to Sister Christian was that members of the band thought he was saying Sister Christian during the recording. So they changed the name of the song and re-recorded it with the word Christian in it. So that's why it's a song about his sister Christy turned into Sister Christian. And he wrote it because he went home to Eugene, Oregon, another reference to Oregon there. And his sister, who was younger than he was by 10 years, was growing up, and she had become a teenager since the last time he had seen her. And she, he felt that she was just growing up too fast. So this song was in reference to her. Nobody really knows, and he never really told the band what all of the words actually meant. You know, like the motor in part and the what's your price for flight. Just words or, you know, lines he threw in there about her growing up. Reached number one in Canada. And only got as high as number two or number five on the Hot 100 in the U.S., got as high as number two in the mainstream rock charts in the U.S. Australia had only got up to 99, so I don't know what Australia's problem was with the song.
Oh, they're upside down on everything.
Right? I mean, and then in Germany, it reached 67. It was, I like it. I love this song. I don't really know if I know too many more Night Ranger songs other than When You Close Your Eyes.
Powerful. But,
yeah. So those are, that's the song of the day that I chose. What do you have any fond memories of Sister Christian?
I remember doing a lot of motoring when I was younger.
Do you?
Yes.
What kind of motoring?
Oh, I don't know what that means. Cruising for chicks. How's that?
Cruising for chicks.
Yes.
I was going to say, I think it means cruising, doesn't it? I would think so.
I don't know.
So there was Powerful. Two different, versions. Did you know that?
What are the two different versions?
Well, there was the album version and then the single version. It was like 45 seconds in difference. They cut one of the verses out for the single. And then in the album, they put the whole song in. The whole song is over 5 minutes.
I just remember the powerful drums. Do, 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 do. Do, 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 do. Drums are powerful.
Dude, there should be a mouth drumming competition. I think you'd win.
Yes. Powerful. Sister Christian. Night Ranger. That's a powerful name for a band, too, isn't it?
Yeah, I don't think you can get any more powerful besides Rat.
Yes. That reminds me of, it'd be like some cool synthwave band now, Night Ranger.
That would definitely have to be one. There'd be a Kinks and Oranges and Purples involved.
Yes, Magentas and...
Yep, a Gridded Sun.
Yes, powerful lasers. And speaking of synthwave, we do have powerful new music from Tangerine Beams.
Ooh.
Stick around for the end of the show. They will play us out. Now let's get into powerful. Yes, we are excited. You can feel the energy, feel the power. Let's get into the powerful shows we watched. The Core. That was your pick. Tell us, the fans of Flock of Amish, about the movie The Core. Core, I'm sorry. The Core.
The Core. C-O-R-E. Okay, well, The Core is a science fiction disaster film, as it's labeled here. From 2003. It's directed by some guy I don't know, John Amell. If people really want to know, we'll let the flock look that up, or if they can decide if they like that person or not. But it does star Aaron Eckhart, Hilary Swank, Delroy Lindo. Stanley Tucci is in this with hair, which is a weird look for him.
Yes.
And then the French actor who I can't never pronounce his name. I think it's the Checky Cake Cario.
Oh.
He is the really? The French general in The Patriot that fights alongside Mel Gibson in that one. So that way the flock knows who we're talking about. DJ Qualls.
Powerful. Road trip.
Yeah, he's not an actual DJ. He just goes by the initials. DJ
Qualls. Yes, he's a powerfully built young man.
Goofy looking
God,
kid.
God, I love that movie, Road Trip.
That was a good movie.
We should talk about that sometime.
We'll do that. We'll definitely do that. Bruce Greenwood and Alfie Woodward.
Oh, love those guys.
DJ Qualls, it's interesting. His character's name is Rat in this, and I never thought that there could be a more accurate character name for someone, and that is an accurate character name for DJ Qualls. He does look like a rat.
Apropos.
Yeah. So the plot of this movie... Aaron Eckhart plays a scientist, geophysicist, more specifically, Josh Keyes, and his scientist buddy, Serge, played by the French dude, obviously. And then Stanley Tucci plays Conrad Zimsky. The three of them find out that the Earth's core has stopped rotating.
That's hardcore.
Is that something you fear?
Yes, that's very hardcore when the core doesn't rotate.
I don't know what I fear most, the core stopping to rotate or a water monitor lizard.
I worry about the mantle a lot.
Do you?
Yes.
Like it falling apart?
I don't know. I don't even know what that means.
Or falling off the wall.
Off the wall.
Into the
powerful
fireplace.
Michael Jackson.
Oh, yeah.
The core stopped moving.
Stops moving, which screws up, of course, like... Everybody knows, I don't have to tell the flock because the flock is smart, that just screws up the Earth's magnetic field. And we have, what did they have? They have birds flying into the windows.
Yes.
And into statues. I'm trying to read, and then people just dropping dead.
Yes, all the people that have pacemakers, the millions of people within the couple block radius.
Yeah, they just drop dead. So they have to go figure out how they're going to get the core moving again. And they come up with this grand plan. Delroy Lindo, his character, has come up with this awesome, boring machine.
Oh, wasn't that boring, was it?
No, well, not really. You know what this movie reminds me? If people have seen Armageddon and they've seen the movie Interspace, it's kind of a combination of both of those in my mind, because you're taking something and going into something and it looks like you're inside of a human body more than in the middle of the Earth.
Honey, I Shrunk the Planet.
Yes, definitely. So they come up with this machine. I don't know if you can't call it a ship, can you? Like a train?
You can call it whatever you want.
Yeah, but it's made out of a material called unobtainium.
Unobtainium?
Unobtainium, there it is, which was a funny name for a made-up material.
Yes, you can't obtain it.
Yeah, I like the qualities of this material. The more pressure and the more heat, the stronger it gets. That way they can.
It's like the Hulk.
They didn't have to deal with like the underwater pressure or the pressure of going into the middle of the Earth. So.
Under pressure.
But yeah, I mean, there's just. When the flock watches us, if they watch it, I mean, they'll see some of the plot holes that go along with that as well.
So all in all, it was a stupid action thriller survival disaster movie.
Yeah, and it came after, so Armageddon, I look back, Armageddon was made in 98. This was made in 2003. So I think they waited long enough for a new apocalyptic end of the world drilling into something to save the Earth with, of course. Nuclear bombs.
Yeah, back to what we should be using for fireworks.
Right, yeah. One of the things, Aaron Eckhart, he can't decide if he's going to be a good actor or not. Cause
he is kind of two-faced, yeah.
Yeah. He'll do a performance and then follow it up with two disaster performances. But I think He only looks for the roles where he can have a scene where he can clench his teeth together and get angry.
Well, he's very handsome. You wish you could look that good, don't you?
I do, yeah. I think it's throughout this movie he's got bedhead, so I kind of wish I had that going on.
You have bald head.
Mm.
How is your bald melon, by the way?
It's good. I'm getting used to the look, so I don't scare myself when I look in the mirror anymore.
Yeah, just so, what I said, just shave that shit down, bick it down. Embrace your baldness.
We're not there quite yet.
I'll just get there.
Baby steps. Amish baby machine steps.
Yes, powerful.
So Hilary Swank plays a...
boxer in this movie, isn't she?
Yeah, this was just before... she's actually training for her role or for the next fight. She lands the shuttle or helps land the space shuttle.
what do you think of that scene with the space shuttle landing?
It was so dumb. I mean, come on. It was funny. It was
they had the cool scaffolding though. That was cool.
Yeah. Tell me what you thought, but were there parts of the movie where you could figure out what they were gonna do before they did it?
Yeah, it was a dumb movie. Let's just get to the ratings. What do you think?
I'm giving it a 2.5.
I'm giving it 2 out of 5 buggy wheels.
Ooh. So I'm a little more excited about this one, I guess, than you.
It would have been funner in the movie theater.
Yeah,
Where did you see it? Where did you just was scrolling through or what?
Yeah, you know, when you and I decide what movies we're gonna go watch or whatever, I just I usually look in the action genre on Netflix, and I just saw it. And I was like, well, let's click on it and see what it says, and I was like, eh, that sounds dumb. Let's watch it. So I didn't expect it to be this dumb, though. So I actually read one of the reviewers trashed the director about how unscientific it was. And sometime after this movie, it wasn't because of this movie, but sometime after this movie, Hollywood actually created a entertainment and scientific board, if you will. So they can ask scientists about sciencey stuff in movies so they can sound somewhat accurate, because I guess this movie was like totally made up. None of the things they said could happen is like ever possible in like physicists and in geophysics. It's just was remarkably dumb, I guess. Lots of scientists just are like, what the F? But I'm gonna kind of give away a little bit here, but there's a part where Aaron Eckhart's character tries to pull the fuel cell, the plutonium fuel cell out, and he tries to use a chain, and the chain melts, and he can't pull it out, but somehow he can pull it out with his hands and carry it up a ladder, and all that happens is he gets like a second or third degree burn.
Did he die?
It's like, are you ridiculous? All right, it melts through a chain, but doesn't melt through a hot pad glove. I don't get that at all.
All right, we're done. That movie sucked.
Yes. I just wanted the flock to know what they were getting into. If they decided to watch it.
Thanks for picking it.
Powerful, hey, no problem.
Powerful movie. And the powerful next show we watched on Netflix was Longmire.
Yeah, this is a TV series. This was a suggestion by you. Tell the flock where you decided to pull this one out of.
I was looking through Netflix also, and it was one of the shows that people were watching.
Ah, it's a trending. All right. Do you want to tell the flock, or do you want me to tell the flock what it's about?
You tell the flock.
All right. So Longmire is a modern Western crime drama. Like I said in the beginning, think CSI Wyoming, but a lot less technical. And you get that right away in the first show. That's the only one I watched. So we're basing an entire series off of one show. How many episodes did you get into?
I watched one show also, because I knew you were going to watch one. So I figured we'll just review the first episode.
All right. So it premiered in 2012 on the A&E network, which is important because the first couple seasons are on A&E, which is an over-the-air network. So you're not going to get any swearing. You're not going to get any hardcore nudity or anything, or anything too bad, just because it was on an over-the-air network. I'm actually pretty intrigued about whether the seasons after that, how that went when it got put on Netflix, because Netflix picked it up after A&E canceled.
A&E was over-the-air? I thought that was cable.
I figure everybody's got cable now. So to me, that's over.
Maybe we should have a science board for you.
Maybe.
Better get your goddamn facts straight.
Well, either way, they're not going to do anything crazy on A&E because everybody gets that channel when they get their cable or their satellite or whatever, their Hulu Plus TV or their YouTube TV, whatever they get. But A&E, or when Netflix picks it up, it usually gets a little more adult after that because there's no rules on Netflix. You can do whatever you want. It's just like any other thing, like HBO. They can do whatever they want. Even though A&E could do whatever they want, they decided not to. Anyway, Walt Longmire is a sheriff in the county of Absaroka in Wyoming. It's a fake county. That county does not exist in real life. He's actually that actor. Is Robert Taylor plays him. He's actually Australian.
Sweet.
And yeah, so he speaks with an American accent throughout the entire show. Series, I would imagine. Couldn't have an Australian sheriff running around Wyoming. I don't think that would work out pretty well. But in the first season, you find out, or the first episode, you find out his wife had recently died. He's dealing with that. He's dealing with the douchebag deputy. That wants his job, who's going to run against him as sheriff of the county. And then he's got a couple of allies in the department, the sheriff does. One of those is Katie Sackhoff, who plays Vic, I believe her name is, in this series. And she is a former homicide detective from Philadelphia. And she moved out to Wyoming, I guess, to become a sheriff's deputy.
Makes sense to me.
Right? I mean, I think that's the normal. Maybe Sergeant Ed could tell us if that's the normal progression. Go from homicide detective to sheriff's deputy in Wyoming. But they have to try to solve the crime of a dead body they find in the middle of nowhere. And like we said, as far as the crime scene investigation goes, they go and roll over the body. They touch the body. They're stepping on everything. They're trying to use a hairdryer to find evidence. It's just, it's a pretty Keystone Cop, if you ask me.
That part I thought was a little weird.
Yeah.
And when they see the body, they start going through it right away. I don't know if that's some cool way to do it out west.
Right. It sounds like... they just threw the body in the back of his truck that he was just going to take it to the hospital too. I mean, it didn't sound like there was a coroner or anybody that picked it up, or there was no crime scene.
There's no Quincy.
Yeah. Ooh, Quincy. You know, he would have had that shit on lockdown.
Yes. Quincy M.E.
Yeah. But yeah, so that was, there was a prostitution ring involved. It was nuts. So there was a little bit of everything. It was the pilot, though. So they, I think they were going all out to make sure that some network picked it up. Lou Diamond Phillips is in this as
well.
Oh,
my God.
I don't know how I buried the lead on that
one. Diamond Phillips.
Yeah.
I knew him when he was Lou Carbon Phillips. He was a young guy back then.
Wow, that was a long time ago. Thousands of years.
Powerful young gun back there.
So what did we think? A lot of pressure on him back then.
Yes, he was under a lot of pressure. What did we think of Longmire?
I think it was all right. I might watch another episode. So because it was a A&E drama series, the flock should know that it's not one story that they keep going on. It's one-offs. Every episode's a different story. But it was all right. I might watch another one just to see if my interest is piqued enough to keep watching it. There's six seasons.
What'd you think of the lead?
Three episodes.
What'd you think of the lead?
He was okay. I didn't mind him too much. I don't think I've ever seen him in anything else. Maybe I have. He didn't look familiar to me. But, you know, strong, you know, sheriff, old, rugged sheriff.
Grizzled.
Yeah, I could see him. Weathered. I believed him as a small town Wyoming sheriff. How about you?
You know, it was a pretty solid show. I liked it. I thought he was pretty cool. I thought the other deputy lady, she was kind of annoying.
Yeah, I could see that.
No, he was pretty cool. I liked it. I liked how, you know, he was kind of solved the mystery. It was a solid show. I'd watch it again. I mean, it had a lot of cliches. It had a lot of, you know, tropes in there. Pretty solid show. I could see it. You know, it's straightforward. I kind of like the out west. I like the backdrop. That was pretty cool. Kind of picturing yourself living out there versus, you know, most crime cop shows are, you know, out east, back east, whatever you want to say, Boston, New York. So it's kind of cool to see how cops would deal with stuff out in Wyoming. And I liked how they went to the Indian reservation. That was kind of cool to see that side of it too.
Right.
I think it was a pretty solid show.
Different jurisdictions.
What's that?
Would you watch the second episode?
I would. Yeah. It was a pretty solid show. I could see it developing into some things. You know, you wonder what he's going to do. He recently lost his wife. You know, is he going to get a new girlfriend, get married? I don't know. I would watch it again.
Yeah. I'm looking up Robert Taylor on Wikipedia. He was in The Matrix. He was one of the agents in The Matrix.
Mr. Anderson.
Yeah, he was Agent Jones, which I don't know any other agents in that one other than Hugo Weaving. But most recently, he was in The Meg, Dr. Heller.
Oh, yes, The Meg.
And he was also the captain of the boat in the Kong Skull Island, the new
Yes.
So that was more recently. He's been in a lot, actually. Looks like his acting career started in 1988, of course, over in Australia. So a lot of the TV shows he was in were down under.
Always seems like the cool macho dudes, you always have to import them, you know?
Yeah, that's true. We had this guy who is a alpha male, Hugh Jackman.
Jackman.
Not from around here. The dude from The Walking Dead. He was a kick-ass character. Mel Gibson. Mel Gibson.
Russell Crowe.
Gerard Butler.
Yes, Gerard Butler. Why is that?
He wasn't from around here. I don't know. Jawline. Nobody believes you can be a strong alpha male without a strong jawline.
Yes. We should bring you in. You have that strong hairline now.
Or lack thereof.
Yes. Powerful.
My God. Disgusting.
It's kind of like those pools that what are the what are those pools called? Infinity pools?
Yeah.
You have kind of like the infinity hairline.
I don't know if that hurts my feelings or makes me feel better.
Look at my melon. My God. It's powerful. It's a powerful dome.
Oh, man. Yeah.
God,
maybe we should try to get the Flock of Amish to tell us what to review next.
Whoa, you're reading my mind. Make sure you follow us on Twitter at Amish Bee Machine. Shoot us out your ideas for something for us to review, and we will be happy to review it.
Yeah, new or old, we will take it.
5 buggy wheels. What are you giving this show?
I'm going to give it a 3. Cool. I liked it better than the core. I guess I might do another episode or two just to see if it piques my interest.
How about Texas Walker crossover?
Oh, that would be nice. We're going to have to dust off Chuck Norris.
Yes, Chuck Norris should be in there. Yep. Powerful dusters and cowboy hats. And
boots, cowboy boots. Yes,
eating baked beans all the time. I'm going to give it a 3 out of 5 also.
All right, cool.
It was a pretty solid show.
Yeah, it wasn't horrible.
No.
So it was a book series first, I guess, by Craig Johnson.
Yeah, at least it wasn't a comic book. It seems like every show now is a comic book.
Or graphic novel.
Yeah, I was just going
to
say,
what they like to be called.
It's actually a graphic novel.
Get the nerds after you.
Well, let's get in some shout-outs. I told the kids on Twitter at Amish Bee Machine I'd shout them out. The first five in, but I can't do math, so I'll do six shout outs here. We got Sergeant Ed. We got the Coffin Cast. But It Was Aliens Podcast. Ben Weston, the Top Six Podcast. Round and Round the Podcast. That's your powerful shout outs for today on the most powerful podcast ever created, the Amish Baby Machine Pop Culture Podcast.
So the Top Six Podcast, we did six. So they should be very happy.
Yes, that was a little shout out to them.
Nice.
Now, as I mentioned, as we started this powerful episode, we do have powerful new music from Tangerine Beams, Terradyne, Father Turbo, their powerful remix. I'm going to powerfully use that to play us out. Did you have a good time tonight on this powerful episode, Mike Rez?
I always have a great time when you and I can talk garbage movies.
Hey,
fun TV shows.
Yes. I'm going to give you a shout out too. Tell the kids of Flock of Amish about your podcast.
All right. The 945 show is a awesome podcast. I interview indie musicians from the Twin Cities where we're at. I'm going to try to get an interview with the Water Monitor if it shows up anytime in the next couple of days. It'll be an exclusive.
I don't like that name, Water Monitor. It sounds like some fucking lifeguard monitoring the pool levels or something.
Well,
your free chlorine is not very good. I'm the water monitor.
I wonder if it has any of those really cool suits that they had on Baywatch. That would be pretty disturbing, but fun to watch.
Mitch Buchanan.
So yeah, the 945 show is available on a ton of podcast platforms. So pick your favorite one. Maybe the one you're listening to Amish Baby Machine on after this one is done, after Tangerine Beams is over. Search the 945 show and check out some great indie music. Now, there's every indie musician that I interview is also the rights holder for their own music. So I get to play full length songs on that show. So that's pretty awesome.
Whoa. Full length, uncut.
Uncut. Yeah. Yes. You're not getting a needle drop right now.
Well, I hope you guys had a good time tonight. Thanks for listening. Got some powerful music here by Tangerine Beams. Make sure you check them out at tangerinebeams.bandcamp.com. And until next time, you've just enjoyed the Amish Baby Machine Pop Culture Podcast.
Thank you for listening to the Amish Baby Machine Pop Culture Podcast. It is available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, and everywhere else fine podcasts are found. Please support our podcast through Patreon and shop our merch at AmishBabyMachine.com. Follow us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube. This has been an Amish Baby Machine production.